Tell us a little bit about your air crew. How many people you had, how young they were?
Well, they're a 10-man crew. After transition at Fort Worth, and you go ahead and you go on your check ride. I still remember Major Rose gave me a five-hour check ride and cleared that. And you go to Lincoln, Nebraska, and you pick up your crew. And then you go out to Casper, Wyoming for overseas training. So this is where this was taken. This photograph was taken at Casper, Wyoming.
Why Casper, Wyoming?
Well, it was just a base there that it had 60 aircraft.
Really?
And so that was a good training base.
You never hear of it. I knew there was a base in Wyoming, but I never hear that it was a World War II base.
Good sized base, yeah.
Wow. Well, you know, Vero Beach here was a Navy training base, and we have lost over, I want to say it's 110, 115 people just training out of here in the 40s. And then the interesting thing about it is your age. How old were you when you went through all this?
Well, when I was going through, first of all, as soon as I became 19 years old, and that was in August of 1942, being born in 1923. And so anyway, there was 2 years, almost 2 years of training, and finally got cleared, or you might say certified with a B-24. At Fort Worth in Texas, and then of course, as I say, picked up the crew and through Casper, Wyoming on the overseas training, and then finishing that, we go down to Topeka to pick up our new aircraft to fly all the way from Topeka to Cerignola, Italy, and so we went through Master, New Hampshire, and then Gander, Newfoundland, Lejeune, in the Azores, Marrakesh, Morocco, Tunis, Tunisia, Gioia, Italy, and then over to Cerignola. So we were all then part of the 15th Air Force,
right?
And pretty notable about all the raids on Ploesti.
Yeah.
Well, refinery. And on that one there on August 1 of 1943, there were 177 B-24s. They called it the tidal wave. And out of that, they made a good low-level raid. But on the way out, the German fighters picked off 54 aircraft.
Wow.
54 aircraft. There were 53 that were still heavily damaged. And what happened to the other 70 remaining? But anyway, they had a successful mission.
Yep.
But they paid a high price from doing it.
Yeah, absolutely. I remember reading about that one.
I was part of the 15th Air Force, but no part of the Ploesti raids.
Right.
But we did have raids on refinery elsewhere. On March 1, here we thought the war was about over, and we got shot up badly. So anyway, the refinery was Mooshbeer bomb near Vienna.
Yep.
And we got lost our oxygen and our fuel, and we go ahead and we landed in Yugoslavia.
Wow.
So we didn't have enough fuel to be able to get back to the base.
Right.
But we were briefed in the morning so as to be able to do that. It was very successful. And so we had to stand by or stay there for 3 or 4 days and be able to have to refuel our aircraft with 5 gallon cans. But anyway, we got back to the base. But we had 135 holes. We had one piece of shrapnel in a nose wheel about that big. And I was surprised to hear I was a 10-man crew and that much going perforating the aircraft. We still didn't have a single injury.
Really?
It had to be a blessing to be able to do that.
Absolutely. You brought everybody home.
Yep. And wow. Here, out of my crew here, I'm the only one left.
Yeah.
I'm the only one left, and I guess it's God's will.
Yep.
And then, of course, here, as I mentioned before, this is my wife of 68 years. And
that's awesome.
And she was a nurse for 53 years.
Wow.
And so she had a real teammate.
Absolutely. And well, that's what it takes.
Current adjutant. Carry out your orders.
Bugler! Sound assembly!
Please take your seats and silence your cell phones. The Memorial Day honors will begin shortly. Welcome to Memorial Day 2015. Across our nation and around the world, our citizens and veterans gather to pay homage to the America's finest men and women, those who gave their lives in combat. Abraham Lincoln called this the last full measure of devotion. It is worth noting that 240 years ago, our nation first went into combat with the American Revolution. 200 years ago, we lost our last few soldiers on the battlefields of the War of 1812. 152 years ago, in 1863, the greatest battle ever fought on U.S. soil took place, the Battle of Gettysburg. 70 years ago, World War II ended. 1953, the Korean War was over. The Vietnam conflict ended in 1973. And soon, perhaps, we will be out of Iraq, or maybe not. More than 1,300,000 of our finest have died on the battlefield to protect our freedom. Because of them, we are able to live in a free society that even our most desperate enemies admire. And these are the Americans that we gather to remember and honor today. Ask yourself where you would be without the personal sacrifice made by these men and women. Because of them, we find ourselves on Vero Beach's Veterans Memorial Island Sanctuary. This sanctuary is reputed to be the most beautiful veterans facility in the United States. Let me review for you what surrounds us. First of all, the National Flag Memorial with our 31-foot garrison flag flying at half-mast in honor of Memorial Day. The 76 cenotaphs that you walked by as you entered, each with its own American flag. A cenotaph is a monument erected to honor those that are buried elsewhere. The majority of those honored here are some young men from Vero Beach, Sebastian, Wabasso, Felsmere, who were lost in combat from World War II forward. Several were prisoners of war, and some of their bodies were never recovered. Memorial Walk circumvents this island. Starting on the north, there are six areas of meditation marked with white pedestals and the flags and the plaques of the Army, Navy, Air Force, Marine Corps, Merchant Marine, and Department of Defense. In the northwest is the Vietnam War Veterans Memorial. In the south is the Korean War Memorial. In the east is a POW MIA Memorial. Also, the Purple Heart Memorial, and in the northwest is the newly renovated Pearl Harbor Survivor Memorial. And get a chance, walk around and take a look at this most beautiful place and observe all the memorials. We can all be proud of this island. And refer to the back page of your program to see the Vero Beach Memorial Island Sanctuary Committee. And also below that, the list of organizations that we could not put on a day like this without their assistance. I have four people on the stage today that I'd like to introduce to you and honor on this Memorial Day. First, Ms. Alba Lee Memorial. Alba Lee Loy, some people call Miss Vietnam, Miss Vero Beach. Alba Lee, would you stand up, please? As you note, she's the vice chairman of the Vietnam Correction, the Veterans Memorial Island Sanctuary Committee. Also, we have three World War II combat veterans on the stage. And I've asked three of our past Veterans Council presidents to introduce them. And those three are Vietnam War combat veterans. First, Colonel Marty Zickert of the United States Air Force.
In the fighter pilot world, the words humble and humility do not exist. Right up until the time I read the biography of this gentleman I'm about to introduce. First Lieutenant Lloyd Smiley. U.S. Army Air Corps, World War II B-24 command pilot, who assembled his 10-man crew for training in Lincoln, Nebraska. He led them to Topeka, Kansas to pick up their brand new four-engine B-24 and flew it alone to Serignola, Italy. Five stops along the way, all of them at night. I've done that, and it's scary. Trust me, imagine what it was like. I did it with an airplane that had an inertial system. They did it by DR and sunlight and nighttime stars. Wow. He joined the 459th Bomb Wing Group. He turned 21 years of age going into combat. Where were you when you were 21? He started at 19, 2 years of pilot training, and then took a crew of 10 people. It was his responsibility to go into combat. They flew 18 combat missions in Italy and Germany, some missions requiring several flights. During the Po Valley, North Apennines, Rhineland, and Central Europe campaigns. His B-24 was hit by enemy flak several times and it survived one landing, emergency landing in Yugoslavia, where they had to wait for 5 days for fuel, and then they refueled that airplane with 5-gallon tanks. That's pretty impressive. Lieutenant Smiley was awarded the Air Medal with 18 oak leaf clusters. 18 oak leaf clusters. He brought his B-24 and the 10-man crew safely back to the United States. That's a tremendous feat. Lieutenant Smiley graduated from MIT under the GI Bill with a degree in industrial management and spent 20 years working in that profession. He's now 91 years old, lives in Grand Harbor with his wife Connie, and they just celebrated their 68th wedding anniversary. I am humbled. Lieutenant Smiley,
next, Sergeant John Michael Matthews of the United States Marine Corps.
Thank you. It's my honor to introduce Philip I. Crum, which I invite to stand, be recognized. Philip Crum enlisted in the United States Navy on his 17th birthday in 1943 with the consent of his parents. His father was a U.S. Navy Seabee. Seaman Crum completed his basic training at Lake Sampson Training Center near Geneva, New York. He chose to serve in the U.S. Navy Armed Guards. This little-known Navy occupation served as guards on merchant marine ships, protecting those vessels against Japanese submarines and land-based aircraft. Each U.S. Navy guard ship detachment was comprised of one Navy officer and 24 Navy gunners. Ship armament included one 5-inch dual-purpose stern gun, one 3-inch anti-aircraft gun in the bow, and 8 20-millimeter machine guns. Seaman Crum's first ship was the U.S. Homestead, which carried 100 octane aviation fuel and 16 P-40 Navy fighters, 4,300 miles from San Francisco to the Philippines. He then returned to the U.S. on the U.S. Grays Harbor 3 times through the Panama Canal to pick up aviation fuel in Aruba, Navy aircraft in Panama, and make deliveries to Okinawa and Guam. They avoided Japanese torpedoes, numerous floating mines, and aircraft. Seaman Crum is 89 years old and has been married to his wife Claire for 45 years, and they live in Vero Beach. Also, Seaman Crum is the past president of the Navy League of the United States and life member, and also has authored a book on the U.S. Navy Armed Guards. So, honor Dr. Seaman Crum.
Lieutenant Colonel Rip Weiler, United States Marine Corps. I am honored to introduce to you Private First Class Chase Adams, United States Marine Corps. On February 19, 1945, at 19 years of age, he landed on the island of Iwo Jima
in the third wave as a member of the 5th Regiment Engineer Red Battalion, the 28th Marine Regiment of the 5th Marine Division. As a demolition expert, his duties included clearing minefields, destroying Japanese pillboxes and caves with satchel charges, and at times acting as a stretcher bearer for the more than 25,000 Marine casualties over this 8-day battle. He was on the mountainside when the famous Marine Corps flag was raised on Mount Suribachi. His Marine Regiment was awarded the Presidential Unit Citation. By the time he was discharged, he also received the Asiatic Pacific Campaign Medal with a Bronze Star, a World War II Victory Medal, a World War II Navy Occupation Medal with a Japan Bar, and the American Campaign Medal. Following discharge, he attended Miami University under the GI Bill and participated on their swimming team. He is a member of the Barefoot Bay Marine Corps League and lives here in Vero Beach at Harbor Chase. He is 90 years young. Please give it up for the first of the three, for the last of the Marine, Your Honor.
Parade Marshal, sound attention.
Bugler, sound attention.
Parade Marshal commits the ceremony.
Parade Adjutant, report.
All present are accounted for, sir.
Corporal Harris, post.
Aye, sir.
The opening invocation for today will be offered by Captain Retired Dick Flick, United States Navy, the chaplain of the Indian River County Veterans Council. Please rise for the invocation and remain standing for our national anthem and the Pledge of Allegiance led by Lynn Marie St. Vincent of the Military Moms Prayer Group.
Where War Comes Home by Robert M. Poole. For most of the country, the longest war in the history of the United States has taken place largely out of sight. The casualties piling up in faraway Iraq and Afghanistan, while normal life continues on the home front. With no war taxes, no draft notices, no gas rationing, and none of the shared sacrifice of the nation's earlier conflicts. Let us pray. Almighty, all-powerful, all-loving God, we come to you in a very special way, in a very honored way, in a very humble way on this Memorial Day. As we look at the center of the court, we see there the helmet, the boots, what some of us call the peace. We see there representing men and women whose futures have been cut short. Sons, daughters, husbands, wives, who will not come home. Dear God, help us as a nation. Help us as honorable people.
Help us as people who believe in the Constitution, who believe, yes, God, in freedom and in the greatness of America. Help us that we may find our place, dear God, that we may make sacrifice and give thanks and praise for those who have given their all for our country. And that sometimes we might feel pain, real pain, when we recognize how much of America and the freedom we have we take for granted. And so, Almighty God, with your presence here, with your power and with your love, we thank you for all those who serve our country in any way, past and future. But more than anything, God, this morning, we lift to your love and your throne of grace the families, the loved ones, yes, God, those who have given their all for the United States of America. Amen.
Battalion, present!
Please render honors to our national flags and accompany the band from Vero Beach High School in our national anthem. Pledge of Allegiance.
If everyone can please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Addie!
Please be seated. Once again, we're very pleased to have with us the Vero Beach High School Band under the direction of Dr. James Sammons and Paige Howell. They well deserve. The band will play a medley of patriotic music. Thank you, Dr. Simmons. Now, Corporal Heath Harris of the United States Marine Corps will place a wreath of freshly cut flowers among the cenotaphs to your rear. These memorial markers are dedicated in remembrance to all those who gave their lives to our service of our country.
Battalion! Archers! Corporal Harris,
retrieve
the
cutlass. Magpiper Michael Hyde of the U.S. Merchant Marine will lead Corporal Harris to the cenotaph location.
time. Us hoops. Ready.
Please be seated. Now please give your attention to our vocalist, Sergeant Terrence T. Nelson of the Vero Beach Police Department.
I'll breathe out all.
It is my distinct honor to introduce our Memorial Day 2015 keynote speaker. Thomas G. McInerney is a retired United States Air Force Lieutenant General. He is a command pilot with more than 4,100 flying hours, including 407 combat missions in Vietnam. He also served overseas with the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, the Pacific Air Forces, and as commander of the 11th Air Force in Alaska. He served four tours in Southeast Asia, and currently he's a frequent contributor analyst to the Fox TV News channel. He graduated from the United States Military Academy at West Point in 1959, graduated from the Armed Forces Staff College in 70, received a master's degree in international relations from George Washington University in 72, and graduated from the National War College in 1973. General McInerney's last duty assignment was Assistant Vice Chief of Staff, Headquarters, United States Air Force. His awards and decorations include the Distinguished Service Medal with Oak Leaf Cluster, the Defense Superior Service Medal, the Legion of Merit with Oak Leaf Cluster, the Distinguished Flying Cross with Oak Leaf Cluster, Bronze Star Medal with V Device at Oak Leaf Cluster, and the Air Medal with 17 Oak Leaf Clusters. General McInerney.
Thank you, Sam, as well as Colonel Tony Young and Marty Zickert. Appreciate you being here. And the 21 member organizations that comprise the veterans of Indian River County, as well as your sponsors, this magnificent band, the Color Guards, and I must do a shout out for the Merchant Marine as well. On this Memorial Day, we honor those that gave their lives to defend our nation's freedom. Our first Memorial Day was on 30 May 1868, after the Civil War, in which there were over 600,000 Americans killed on both sides. And we called it Decoration Day, which many of us remember that term until 1971, when the Congress changed it to Memorial Day and celebrated it on the last Monday in May. We have lost, as Sam mentioned, almost 1.3 million Americans killed in action since the Civil War. We honor not only them, but those that have survived and have now departed God's golden earth, golden green earth. Most, if not all of us here today, have relatives or friends killed in action, as well as those that fought in World War II, Korea, Vietnam, Desert Storm, Afghanistan, Iraq. Afghanistan and Iraq is the war against radical Islam, which I call it, because it is not a global war on terror, as President Bush's administration called it, nor is it an overseas contingency operation, as President Obama and his administration call it. No, it is a global war against radical Islam that ISIS and Iran are now leading the charge. And this is very important, because I am going to take the solemnity of this important day and show why those that died for our freedoms expect us, living today, to defend those freedoms and understand this global threat. This ideology is as evil as Nazism, fascism, and communism, against which so many Americans lost their lives in combat defeating these ideologies. Three of them are up on the stage here with us today. Let's remember that all the American lives lost in the 20th and 21st century were lost by defeating those ideologies that would take the freedoms we enjoy today away from the United States. That is why we honor their sacrifices as well as those that survived and won those battles. Many of you are here today. Three are on the stage, as I said. But who are no longer with us today, we cannot thank them enough. Now, I would like to personalize this by mentioning those that I know from my earliest memories until today. First, Lieutenant Colonel Fred Terry, killed in action in 1944 in the European Theater of Operations, actually France. His son, Fred Jr., was our closest friend. We were 8 at the time, and he lost his father. It was tragic, but it instilled to this day the memory of what those that fought for us have done. In Korea, although I did not know any of the people there at that time, Lieutenant Dan Folberg, the class of 1950 at West Point, was one of my boyhood idols because he was captain of the 1949 Army football team. Vietnam, of course, was much closer to home for me, as it was to Sam and so many people here today. But I remember Captain Don Hollander, the class of 1956, an All-American football player, but most of all, my company commander during my days as a plebe at West Point. Every morning, I saw Holly standing up in front of the company, just like we have here today. Captain Rocky Versace, another classmate of mine, who won the Medal of Honor while captured by the Viet Cong in November 1963 in Kamau Province, South Vietnam, and endured years of harsh captivity. His story was told by a Captain Nick Rowe, the class of 1960, who escaped and told that story that enabled the U.S. Army to award Rocky the Medal of Honor for his heroism as a prisoner. But Nick was later killed in Manila as the army attaché by Philippine communists. My younger brother Dick, the class of 60, who was on his second tour in combat in Vietnam when he was killed in March 1967 as a company commander in the 1st Cavalry Division. Let me fast forward to the Libyan raid in 1986, where I was the commander from the United Kingdom and launched the airplanes from four of my bases. Major Ferdinand Ribas Domenici and Captain Paul Lards were the only two casualties we had on that mission against Colonel Gaddafi when he attacked U.S. forces in Berlin. But we also honor those veterans who served in combat and have since departed on their final flight west, as airmen say. I specifically remember Navy Captain Daniel C. Dennison, who was a naval officer in the Delta region during the Vietnam War, and whose lovely widow, Carol Dennison, is here with us today, and with her sister, Gail. Can you both stand up, please? God bless you, Carol. I would also like to remember my older brother, who has since departed since our last Memorial Day, Major General James E. McInerney, Jr., the class of 52 at West Point, who passed away in 14 October 2014. He was the leading ace in the Vietnam War with the most SAM sites destroyed, with 16 kills. Finally, on my very personalized review, I cannot forget my father, Colonel James E. McInerney, the class of 23, who was one of the first troops to go over in World War I with the 11th Engineers, came back, went to West Point, and was in the European Theater of Operations, England, France, and Germany during World War II. I didn't see him for 3 years. And finally, my twin brother, John, who died shortly after graduation of Hodgkin's disease from West Point. I ask you to also personally remember your relatives and friends and take a moment of silence. May their souls rest in peace. Now, this year is the 70th anniversary of the end of World War II, in which 400,000 plus Americans were killed. The 65th year of the start of the Korean War, which we lost 33,000. The 55th year of the start of the war in Vietnam, which we lost 47,000. And the 14th year of the war against radical Islam, which is where I would like to focus my remaining thoughts on why this Memorial Day is so important. As you may have noticed, I did not mention any of the people killed, men and women killed in Afghanistan, where we've lost 2,229, nor Iraq, where we lost 4,488. And by the way, Afghanistan is not over yet. They, like so many, are a different generation than me, but not for you necessarily. So many of you here may have lost your friends, loved ones, or relatives, all of which is so troubling because it is not over yet by a long shot. I cannot let this Memorial Day go by without touching on my concern for not only the dangers to America, but the whole Western world, if we do not address and defeat radical Islam. The Obama administration is leading a group called the P5 Plus One, which is composed of the U.S., the United Kingdom, France, China, Russia, and Germany, that are about to conclude a nuclear treaty with Iran, which will give Iran a nuclear capability. Now, I know that the president says it will give us the world a 10-year window without Iran having nuclear weapons. But I remind you, if you like your doctor, you can keep your doctor. If you like your health care, you can keep your health care. I no longer look at his words, but I look at his actions. To wit, we give Iran $700 million a month. No, I corrected by Senator Ted Cruz when I had dinner with him. We give Iran $700 million every 28 days. So some months they get $1.4 billion to engage in these talks. Now these dollars are not being used to build hospitals and help education in Iran. They're being used to fuel radical Islamic jihadism in Iraq, Syria, Lebanon, and Yemen, to name a few. It is certainly not being used, as I said, to help the Iranian people. At the successful conclusion of these talks, they get $30 billion. The final agreement is due 1 July, roughly 30 days from now, 31 days. I predict that if not completed by then, this administration will extend it. Why wouldn't the Germans, with almost $6 billion of annual trade, plus the Russians and Chinese wanting to pin down the United States in the Middle East while they have venturism in the Ukraine, in the South China Sea, building islands, why wouldn't they want it to be extended? They are not our friends. Wake up, America. When the Saudis say they will go nuclear the day after Iran does, the United Arab Emirates and the Egyptians are planning to do the same if we agree to this agreement, why would we do this? This is not even a treaty. This is the first time in the history of nuclear warfare in the United States that any time we negotiated with nuclear weapons, it didn't become a treaty requiring two-thirds passage by the Senate. Beware, America. This is very treacherous. I equate it to the September 1938 in which Neville Chamberlain signed the Munich Agreement. Many of you remember from your history, some of us remember it. He came back with a letter. He said, peace in our time. 1 year later, we had the largest war in the history of mankind in which 60 million people were killed. I do not know why President Obama wants Iran to be the hegemon on the Arabian Peninsula. But it, along with ISIS, is very dangerous to America and to the Western world. In conclusion, on this sacred Memorial Day for America, to honor these 1.3 million approximately killed in action, and those that survive, but who are no longer with us, we should not desecrate all they did to let radical Islam dominate our freedoms. So stand up, America. Stand up, America. And honor their sacrifice with our determination to defeat this evil ideology that they paid the ultimate price to defeat. God bless all of them, God bless all of you, and God bless America. Thank you very much.
Please be seated. Thank you, General, for that very inspiring and informative talk. I want to let you know that the General flew down here at his own expense yesterday. We had a small reception for him last night. He has to catch a plane at 1:30 to go back to Washington, D.C. to be with his family for Memorial Day. How about another round of applause? Please rise. Chaplain Fleck, please offer us the benediction.
Almighty God, again, how we thank you for your love and for your care, for your presence with us. We've heard very clearly and very plainly the call today to stand up as Americans. Help us, God, to remember that we do have a strong religious heritage as a part of American winning, America being strong, America standing for freedom. And so, God, now we ask your blessing, a very special blessing on this Memorial Day, upon those family and friends who have lost real named, real people in their lives and in their families and in their homes. Only you, God, know what the days ahead bring. But more than anything, God, we ask you to help us that we might join hands and hearts and understand that the strength of America is in its people, in what its people believe, in what its people stand for. We ask this prayer now. We ask this prayer now, Almighty God. Amen. Amen.
Parade Marshal, prepare for the final salute.
Up higher! Up stairs! Ho! Honor guards, retrieve your colors. Freeze there! Ho! Thank you. in review.
Aye, sir. Battalion, pass in review.
General McInerney and Colonel Young will take the review of the procession going out. The Bachelor's Academy, Fife and Drum Corps. Indian River County Sheriff's Office. Vero Beach Police Department. Indian River County Fire Department. Daughters of the American Revolution. Daughters of the American Revolution. The Marine Corps of League. Vero Beach Veterans. Vietnam Veterans of America. Vero Beach High School Junior ROTC. The Veterans of Foreign War Corps and Honor Guard. And Michael Hyde and the Hershey Braves. This concludes our full Memorial Day honors for 2015. As you depart, please help the Vero Beach Recreation Department by cleaning up your programs and water bottles, and there's depositories at the end. Have a wonderful weekend, everyone.